السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا محمدٍ وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسانٍ إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him for everything that He has bestowed upon us. We ask Him to grant us forgiveness this beautiful eve, the month of Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all and bless every single one of us. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, the kuffar of Quraysh were quite foolish. They knew they were facing a truthful man and honest man. They knew that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not known for having uttered a single lie prior to the time he came with prophethood. So in their hearts, they knew that this cannot be a lie. But because of the arrogance that they had, some of them decided to invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And instead of invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a good prayer, they decided to curse themselves. In what way? So there is a narration by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, rahimahumullah, muttafaq alayh, by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. He says, Abu Jahl made the following dua. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of it, verse number 32 of Surah Al-Anfal. وَإِذْ قَالُوا اللَّهُمَّ إِن كَانَ هَذَا هُوَ الْحَقَّ مِنْ عِنْدِكَ فَأَمْطِرْ عَلَيْنَا حِجَارَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ أَوْ ائْتِنَا بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Allah says, remember when they called out to Allah, they said, oh Allah, if this is the truth, if this is really the truth from you, then we want you to send down from the heavens stones in terms of rain. We want you to send stones down upon us, or we want you to serve us with a very painful punishment. Imagine, they could have asked, they could have said that, oh Allah, if this is the truth, send gold to us. If this is the truth, make us wealthy, make us happy, grant us the best of this world and the next. But because of their arrogance, they said, oh Allah, if this is the truth, punish us, let's see. You know, it reminds me of the little arrogant kids. They say, what you gonna do? And then when you get one slap, then you keep quiet. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. We don't need to say what you're going to do. We'd rather say, oh Allah, grant us goodness. Oh Allah, help us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds. And according to a narration mentioned by At-Tabari in his tafsir, the narration is that of Sa'id ibn Jubayr radiallahu anhu. He says the statement was uttered by An-Nadr ibn al-Harith. So some of the scholars have said this statement was uttered by more than one person. They said, oh Allah, if really this is the truth, punish us. You know, send stones from heaven. So Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. Allah was never going to punish them while you were in their midst. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they expect us to throw stones from the top, but you are in their midst. We will not do that. Subhanallah. We learn from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love for a single person in our midst sometimes is what may result in the protection of the lot of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May He strengthen us. This is why it's good to have good company, to be in good company, to make sure that you are around people who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that perhaps when Allah has mercy on them, we may feel that mercy as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand this very deep ruling. And at the same time, the next part of the verse, Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. And Allah was never going to punish them while they were repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone repents to Allah, the punishment is held back. Brothers and sisters, in your life, remember one thing. You want goodness, you want protection from punishment, you want protection from evil. One of the most powerful ways of achieving it is simply astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I seek your forgiveness. I seek your forgiveness. Keep on seeking Allah's forgiveness. Here, Allah says, if you seek His forgiveness, He holds back the punishment. Imagine. So this is why, get used to it. The Prophet ﷺ did not need istighfar. He was spotless. He was perfect. He was sinless. But still, he used to say, oh Allah, forgive me, up to 100 times a day. With us, we need it desperately. The whole month goes by, we have not yet said it 100 times. And if we do, we say it without concentration. Brothers and sisters, it's about time we took heed and we turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of us complain about wealth, complain about happiness. But when did we turn to Allah? Allah says, if you ask Allah's forgiveness, what would He do by punishing you? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Then Allah says,
وَمَا لَهُمْ أَلَّا يُعَذِّبَهُمُ اللَّهُ وَهُمْ يَصُدُّونَ عَنِ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ وَمَا كَانُوا أَوْلِيَاءَهُ.
Telling them that they would definitely be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they block people from the masjid, from al-masjid al-haram, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then indeed, nothing would stop Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from punishing them. May Allah protect us. Brothers and sisters, we need to understand, these are the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've said it in the past. The guests who are seated here are not my guests or yours. They are the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make them feel comfortable in this beautiful house of Allah, and Allah will make you feel comfortable in the rest of your life. Understand that, do not harm people in the house of Allah. Do not let off an offensive smell where they feel uncomfortable while they are the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although the verse is connected to Al-Masjid Al-Haram, and it's a much broader scale, but we can implement it in our own lives, in the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope and pray that we've actually learned a beautiful lesson from this. Then, if you take a look at acts of worship, my brothers and sisters, in Islam, the acts of worship are always calm. They are always very, very relaxing. They are soothing. They are always very, very plugged in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, full of spirituality. Look at salah. When you stand in salah, there is concentration. There is no screaming, shouting, yelling, clapping, whistling, dancing, movement that is unacceptable and so on. You're not even allowed to bounce in salah. You're supposed to stand extremely still as possible, and you're supposed to concentrate. However, when it comes to people of other faiths, take a look at their acts of worship. They wave their hands, they jump from side to side, they scream and shout, they whistle and they clap and they dance and they engage in lots of noise, and they consider that acts of worship. I'm sure you may have witnessed people of other faiths, be they Christians or Jewish or anyone else, how they have now worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, similar to the mushriks at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes them. Verse number 35 of Surah Al-Anfal. When the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to engage in tawaf very quietly, very calm, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to engage in tawaf and so on, these people used to come up and they used to disturb the peace by whistling and clapping and dancing and waving hands and doing all sorts and claiming that that is worship. So Allah says,
وَمَا كَانَ صَلَاتُهُمْ عِنْدَ الْبَيْتِ إِلَّا مُكَاءً وَتَصْدِيَةً.
Their acts of worship at Masjid al-Haram was nothing more than whistling and clapping. That was their act of worship. That is not an Islamic act of worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us, you be calm, you be relaxed. You want to worship Allah, you don't need to jump and you don't need to dance and you don't need to scream and you don't need to yell and you don't need to whistle and you don't need to clap. You need to engage exactly as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam engaged, and you will be involved in acts of worship. So let us learn a lesson. What they do, people of other faiths, they actually blow the balloon of what they may term spirituality, but it is just an emotional bubble. They get you onto a high. You feel that you've worshipped your maker, but you haven't. At the end of the Sunday, you go home to a lot of alcohol and perhaps adultery, and your week is depressing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not let that happen to us. We worship Allah every single day, 5 times a day, regularly, calm, relaxing, soothing, no noise, whistling, clapping, etc. That is not acts of worship. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand this beautiful lesson. So this narration is mentioned by Al-Wahidi, narration of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, also in Tafsir Ibn Kathir, where he speaks about how they used to worship and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this beautiful verse. Then Tafsir Ibn Kathir makes mention of a narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He says, after the battle of Badr, there were quite a lot of the cronies of Quraysh who died, who were actually killed off in the battle. They came to fight the Muslimin and they lost their lives. From amongst them, Abu Jahl and the likes. Some of their children, they went to Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan then became the leader. He was a wise man. He was quite intelligent. He became the leader of Quraysh. And what happened is, they went to him when he was coming back with one of the caravans from Asham, and they told him, why don't you help us with all this wealth so that we can purchase weaponry, we can plan and prepare, and we can go and attack the Muslimin. So news got to the Muslimin to say these people are spending a lot of money in order to come and inflict harm on you. They are spending a lot of money in order to prepare to block the Muslims from practicing Islam, and at the same time to harm and attack. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses that calmed the hearts of the true believers. Verse number 36 of Surah Al-Anfal.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ لِيَصُدُّوا عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ.
Indeed, the disbelievers or the kuffar will continue spending their wealth in order to transgress or to block from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to harm the Muslimin, to block the Muslimin, to cause any form of damage to the Muslims, to perhaps attack the Muslimin. Allah says, what is their job? Their job is to spend money in that direction. فَسَيُنْفِقُونَهَا. They will definitely spend their wealth. Let them spend it.
ثُمَّ تَكُونُ عَلَيْهِمْ حَسْرَةً.
Then it will be a means of loss for them. They will lose. They will spend it, and on top of that, they will still lose.
ثُمَّ يُغْلَبُونَ.
Then they will be overcome as well on top of that. Take a look at what happened later on. The Battle of Uhud took place, the Battle of the Trench took place, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah took place, and the victory of Makkah came into play. Subhanallah. What happened to all the wealth they were spending? Everything exactly as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. They spent it, they wasted it, it was a loss, and on top of that, they lost. They were overcome. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Remember, whenever people have planned against us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate planner. Whenever people have planned against you as an individual in your life, people plan your downfall. Sometimes even from amongst us as Muslimin, we have hatred, enemy, jealousy, envy, and so on, where one plans the downfall of the other. The one who is the oppressor, remember, they will be served a blow by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It cannot happen that Allah lets it go by. He might let it go past for a little while, but a time will come when the rope will be pulled. This is why the lesson I have to draw from this beautiful verse for my own life is, let me never ever spend my wealth in order to harm other people, in order to damage people, in order to involve negatively in the lives of others, be they whoever they are. We'd rather involve in a positive way. Even if we are reaching out to the non-Muslims, let's reach out in a way that they can find the goodness in this beautiful faith, that they can see and they can get the guidance. We can find them in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, engaging in prayer because they feel the warmth in the hearts, in their hearts, rather than engaging in their lives negatively, that they turn away, they hate Islam and the Muslims because of our own actions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Then verse number 47 of Surah Al-Anfal makes mention of how, when the battle of Badr was about to take place, you recall yesterday we made mention of how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's plan was not to meet them in Badr. It was only to go for one caravan of Abu Sufyan, because that wealth belonged to the Muslims initially. But Allah wanted them to go all the way to Badr. So the people of Badr, in fact the kuffar of Quraysh, the disbelievers of Makkah, they happened to gather approximately 1,000 of them, very heavily armed. And they heard that the Muslims are only 300 odd and they are poorly armed. So they were so excited, they came out with their singers, with their women, with their wealth, with their alcohol and wines, and they came out with everything. They came out in their arrogance and haughtiness with all their top stuff. They wanted to show it. You know, when they used to go for war, when they knew they were going to win, they used to bring their treasures with them to say, okay, you want to take our wealth, we'll show you, we'll bring it to the battlefield. Still you guys are going to lose. That's how arrogant they were. So they brought everything. Allah wanted them to bring it out. They brought as much as they could, their women, their dancers. And guess what happened? That evening, they were so convinced that the following day they're going to win. They started drinking and dancing and whining and dining and everything else. And they were half in their minds because, you know, they're suffering what we call in this part of the world, babalas. Have you heard that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. That means a person who's half drunk, they get up in the morning and they don't know what they're saying. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, really. So when they got up in the morning ready for the battle, they were greater in number. They had more weapon. They had everything. But guess what? Their minds were not there. So they were swiped in no time. The war was over. The battle was over. The main people of Quraysh were all gone, assassinated. Everything was done. And guess what? The wealth and the weaponry and everything came into the hands of the Muslimin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us learn a lesson. Tafsir al-Tabari and Tafsir ibn Kathir, narrated by Muhammad ibn Ka'b. He says, when Quraysh came out on the day of Badr, they were boasting. They came out with drums, musical instruments and women and dancers and so on. So Allah revealed verses later on to the believers, warning us, don't boast, don't brag, don't come out to show force for nothing, to boast to people, to show off, never. Verse number 47,
وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بَطَرًا وَرِئَاءَ النَّاسِ وَيَصُدُّونَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ.
Don't be like those who came out of their houses with pride in order to show off and in order to block from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So obviously this is a powerful verse. How does it apply to us in our lives? So some scholars happen to say that in today's times, and this is obviously just one opinion, I'm not making mention of both, but you'll understand the other opinion. But one of the opinions says, Allah is telling us here, don't waste your time showing off to people that we are big in number. We have so much, and yet you've done nothing to solve the problem. So some of the scholars say, in today's world, a lot of the demonstrations that people engage in order to chant slogans and to show large numbers, have actually achieved nothing. They've actually achieved nil. This is one opinion. Obviously, it is because Allah is saying, verse number 47 of Surah Al-Anfal, do not be like those who've wasted their time coming out of their houses in large numbers in order to show off, in order to pride their numbers and whatever noises they can make. But in essence, they've done nothing. Subhanallah. So I think it is a powerful lesson to think about. I'm not speaking pro or anti demonstration, but what I am saying, it requires a lot of thought. Sometimes we spend millions of dollars planning a demonstration, whereas had we spent that to build perhaps tents for the refugees that we were demonstrating for, perhaps we might have solved the problem. May Allah help us. It's just a matter of thinking. It's just a point to ponder over, my brothers and sisters. Then verse number 66 of Surah Al-Anfal. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the strength of the iman and the belief of the people was such that these enemies of Mecca who were being fought and those who wanted to attack the Muslimin, the rule was that for every one believer, if there were 10 disbelievers, 10 of the kuffar, the battle had to take place. So say for example, they were 300 believers and 3,000, for example, kuffar. The battle had to take place. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had this rule in place that for every one of the strong believers, they would overcome 10 of those kuffar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us strength. 1 to 10. Because the iman was solid. Now when these verses were revealed, some of the sahaba radiallahu anhum, they felt it a bit heavy. I'm going to face 10 here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses. But before I get to this verse, some people who don't know much of the history of Islam, they tend to feel that what is all this about war? It's only a few of these surahs that have made mention of war. It is because when Islam came about, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he declared the faith and he told them to stop worshipping their stones and idols, they did not just want to listen to him. They attacked him, they harmed his people, they killed so many of them, they drove them out of their homes. So naturally, there was a liberation struggle in order to come back and achieve independence. It was a struggle of independence. The victory of Makkah was actually the date of independence of the Muslimin, where they got back their usurped land, they got back their pride, they got back what belonged to them. They got back, they came back to their homes that they were driven out of. So if you look at it from that angle, it was actually a liberation struggle. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So it is similar to making mention of all these matters that have taken place at that particular time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then makes mention, verse number 66, Surah Al-Anfal.
الآن خفف الله عنكم وعلم أن فيكم ضعفا.
Allah has now made it easier for you. He has given you a discount. He's made it easier for you. He knows that there is weakness in your midst.
فإن يكن منكم مئة صابرة يغلبوا مئتين.
Now, we will only compel you to fight if their number is double yours. If it is more than double, you don't need to fight. You can actually sign a treaty, you can actually do whatever you have to, but you don't need to fight. So at the beginning it was 1 to 10. Then Allah made it easy. He said, no, okay, 1 to 2. So now, for example, if the Muslims were 1,000 and the kuffar happened to be more than 2,000, they did not need to actually participate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand this ruling. It was something that was very interesting. It was the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a result of the feeling within the hearts of the believers that 1 to 10 is going to be very, very difficult. And like I said, people might ask, what's all these verses of war all about? The truth is, that's what happened at the time. That's what took place. So yes, the lesson is drawn by us to this day regarding the strength and the weakness and so many more rulings that are definitely extracted. But the implementation of verses of war, my brothers and sisters, remember one clear-cut ruling. They need to only be implemented under strict conditions. And these conditions, a whole long list of them. There needs to be a war. There needs to be a supreme leader. There needs to be so much more that is happening. And then only would these verses actually be brought into play. As I said right at the beginning of this series, the first day that we spoke about the verses, that there are verses that were revealed at times of war and verses at times of peace. We do not implement the verses of peace at the times of war or vice versa. We need to know this. And this is why people who have less knowledge, they confuse the verses of the Quran and they think that we are supposed to implement it all at all the time. You know, if you want to, for example, cut the hand of a person. It's not just any ordinary person. We explained it. There's deep rulings. It needs to be a thief. They need to have stolen from whatever. They need to have been of such a level of mentality. They need to have been witnesses. All these conditions need to be met, and then only will you talk about amputation. A fool is he who reads the verse and says, right, come, let's chop everybody's hands off. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. This is how verses of the Quran are being misconstrued, misinterpreted. And the young are being brainwashed by such false explanations. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand the beauty of going through reasons of revelation of the verses of the Quran. Ameen. Verse number 67. Also something very interesting. After the Battle of Badr, there were people who were taken captive. And from amongst them, some of them were the seniors of Quraysh. Some of them were related to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His uncle Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib was one of them. And his cousin was another one, the brother of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And there were quite a few who were taken captive. Now one might ask, what did they do with prisoners of war at the time? Well, I can tell you, they never ever put them in orange uniforms. They never ever shackled them and gave them a little dog kennel to live in for 20 years. Never ever did Islam do that. Islam treated them like human beings, fed them with the same food that the Muslims ate, clothed them with the same clothing that they were clothed with. And Islam actually came and honored them and respected them by giving them a few options. Yes, they were court-martialed. Those from amongst them who were found guilty of war crimes, perhaps they may have faced what today is known as a firing squad, or they may have faced assassination or execution because of their guilt. To this day, those who have perpetrated crimes, no matter where they have, when the court finds them guilty and a death sentence is passed, what happens? The world is silent because they know that they were, after due process of court and so on, they were found guilty of the crime, and this is their punishment. It has happened lately. The same applies with the Muslimin from the very beginning. It was not just haphazard like people are doing today. It was something uniform. There was authority on the land. They were court-martialed and they were found either guilty or they were given an option. So at that time, because this was the first major war, there was a discussion what to do with these prisoners of war. So the Prophet ﷺ asks Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and this hadith is mentioned in Sahih Muslim, Sunan Abi Dawud, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. It's a long hadith. And he says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, what should we do? Should we, you know, execute these people? They are criminals. They have come to kill us. They have already killed so many of us. So we wouldn't be wrong if we actually executed them. What should we do? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the soft man he was, he said, you know what? Set them free. Perhaps let them pay some ransom, or see each one, the case of each one, and perhaps let them loose. And this letting loose is not like you wait for 15 years and then let them loose, knowing from day one that they're innocent. No. It was the same day or a few days later. But Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu says, O Messenger, these are the warriors. These are the warriors. These are the people who came to kill us. They're going to come back again. So the best thing for you to do is to execute them. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he decided to free them. How did he decide to free them? Several ways. Those who could afford to pay a certain amount, they paid it and they went. Some of them were released just like that, depending on who they were, how much they participated and what they did. And some of them were told, you can read and write. Well, we want you to teach 10 of our people to read and write, and then we set you free. Which means they paid in a beautiful way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand the beauty of Islam. And they were released immediately. They went back to their homes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses. Verse number 67 of Surah Al-Anfal. مَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍّ أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى حَتَّى يُثْخِنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. It was not for the messenger to have taken or to have had these prisoners of war. No. They should have been court-martialed, perhaps executed. Allahu Akbar. So this came in conformance to the ruling of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. That was what he felt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we should have gone according to what Umar radiallahu anhu said. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu that these verses have been revealed, confirming that your opinion was actually a better opinion. Subhanallah. But it was already such that the ruling had been passed and the people had been freed and so on, and beautiful stories have happened. In fact, I want to go into one beautiful story mentioned in the Tabarani by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, the story of Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib. Also Al-Hakim al-Bayhaqi have mentioned it, a narration of Al-Kalbi, but the story is generally one. Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib is the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was found amongst the captives. He came to attack the Muslims in Badr. So they found with him 20 ounces of gold. Okay. Why he brought so much of gold is because he had said, I am going to be one of the committee who's going to be feeding the army. You know, it needs a lot of wealth to feed 1,000 people, and you need a lot of money. You need to feed people. It's not a joke feeding people every single day a few times, a large number. So he was one of them. But the battle was over in no time. He had all this 20 with him. It was confiscated, the booty. And later on, he was told to pay another amount. And he said, I don't have any amount. I don't have anything. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looked at him and he says, Al-Abbas tells the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you see the 20 that you found with me, 20 ounces, why don't you just accept that and let me free? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, no. He says, but I have nothing. He says, what about the wealth that you gave your wife, Umm al-Fadl, as you were leaving Mecca, and you told her, hide this, keep it, in case something happens to me, you can spend from this on Al-Fadl and our children, and perhaps you'll take care of yourself if I don't come back. Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib was shocked. How do you know? Nobody knows besides me, her, and Allah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah informed me. Subhanallah. Revelation. Miracle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is reported according to some narrations that it was at that juncture that Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib already declared his faith. He knew inside, this is the truth. That's it. It's, you know what? Nobody knew. Nobody at all would have known what I've done. And this was the wealth. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about another very interesting point. You know, we have the houses of Allah. Some people don't come for salah, but they contribute a lot to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they might help in so many different ways. They'll paint it, they'll serve the people, but their link with Allah is severed. Or their link with the worshippers of Allah is very bad. They harm the people, they cause damage and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speaking about Al-Masjid Al-Haram and speaking about the house of Allah in Mecca, Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib, when he was in captivity, that day of Badr, just prior to this incident, some of the Muslimin went to him and said, Al-Abbas, what's wrong with you? You know, you are a person who is now caught captive here. Why don't you accept Islam? Come, you know it's the truth. He says, what are you talking about? We are the ones who have built that house, meaning the Mecca. We are the ones who look after it. We are the ones who quench the thirst of the Hujjaj. We are the ones who put a cover on that Kaaba every year. And he was bragging about it. So according to this narration mentioned in the book known as Asbabun Nuzul of Al-Wahidi, he says, thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses explaining that the two are not the same. Looking after the place is one thing, but being a true believer and adopting the laws of Allah is something completely different. مَا كَانَ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ أَن يَعْمُرُوا مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ شَاهِدِينَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ بِالْكُفْرِ. For the mushrikeen to be building or looking after the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what a waste of time. Bearing witness against themselves that they are kuffar. What's the benefit of it? The next verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and that's verse number 19, أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ وَعِمَارَةَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ كَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَجَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ لَا يَسْتَوُونَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Do you consider it equal to be quenching the thirst of the Hujjaj and to be building or looking after Al-Masjid Al-Haram? Is that equal to the one who believes in Allah and the last day and struggles in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Indeed, the two of them are not equal. And Allah does not guide those who are oppressive. Look at the verses. And this is another narration in Sahih Muslim, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, by An-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu. He says, I was at the mimbar of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina Munawwara. And I heard a man saying, now that I'm a Muslim, I don't have to worry. All I'll do is I'll go for Hajj and I'll be pouring Zamzam for all the Hujjaj. And that's it, my Jannah. Another man says, no, all I'm going to do is I'm going to go to Mecca and I'll make sure that I build the Kaaba, or meaning the Masjid, and I look after it and I renovate it and I ensure that everything is done. And here comes another man and he says, no. He says, to struggle in the cause of Allah is far more valuable. He says, to be able to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, work against your whims and fancies, far more valuable. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu heard this commotion. Where was the commotion? In Medina, Munawwara, at the mimbar of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu hears this commotion, he says, keep quiet. This is Jumu'ah and this is the mimbar of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Stop making noise here. And later on, verses were revealed. Verses were revealed, the verses I just read, saying that these two are not the same. Indeed, we need to worship Allah and Allah alone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. My brothers and sisters, one very important point. Tomorrow, inshallah, we'll be continuing with Surah At-Tawbah. And Surah At-Tawbah has a lot to do with the battle of Tabuk. And we will see what the hypocrites did. Very deep, in-depth stories and details and verses that were revealed that exposed the hypocrites. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from hypocrisy. We hope to be meeting with you again tomorrow. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.